Hello everybody, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and in today's video we are going to be discussing armets and this example of a reproduction of the Cherbourg number S18 armet. So around the same time that the great bassinet was taking off in popularity, in Italy, they were experimenting with ways to make the helmet more close-fitting to the actual human form. If you think about the way the bassinet tends to go on, you put it over the top of your head and slide it down into place. So the bottom opening can never be smaller in circumference than the largest part of your head, which tends to be the brow. But if you think about the way your head is shaped, below the brow, your head tends to get narrower down to the jaw, and then below the chin, it gets even narrower around your neck. So in order to get a helmet to fit closely, it requires some sort of hinged or moving component. There were a couple different ways to approach this problem, and I find it difficult to talk about the beginning of armet design without also addressing another family of helmets that took a similar but slightly different approach to this problem, and that is the Venetian great bassinets. So this is kind of an interesting family of helmets. There are several survivals, and what you're going to see is this is what they look like. So this is an example of a Venetian great bassinet. It has a side pivoting visor. The top of the skull is very similarly shaped to contemporary bassinets, but the most notable design difference is this big hinge on what would be the wearer's right side. It's composed of a lot more plates than a normal bassinet of the time, but what this hinge does is it allows that cheek plate to swing open so that you can get your head into the helmet and then secure it in place. You'll see down on the center of the neck there is a locking pin mechanism to keep the cheek in place. If you look at it from the front, you'll also see that there's only a hinge on what would be the wearer's right side. Remember in previous videos when we talked about asymmetry in armor, when it usually manifests itself on the right side being the more compromised side and the left side being the more well-defended side, because of the side on which you're more likely to take a blow, especially a lance shot. You'll also notice, here's another example. Unfortunately, the hinged cheek plate does not survive on this, but the visor is similar, except this one only has a single sight. So the sight goes all the way across instead of two individual sights like the previous one we looked at. Here's another example with a much wider facial opening, and again, hinged on the right side of the cheek plate. It actually starts to be reminiscent of the later form of the barbout. There are also several visors that are listed as bassinet visors that survive, that have a very similar design to what we see on the Venetian great bassinets. Here are a few examples, and you'll see that they're all very similar in their basic appearance. Again, some have a single sight across, some have a double sight, but they're all relatively shallow visors pointed a little bit towards what would be like the bridge or the nose to kind of close that gap formed by the shape of the helmet. So that once the cheek piece is in place, the visor's down, it's actually very enclosed, but fits better to the narrower parts of the head than, say, earlier bassinet styles. So now taking a look at what would be considered the first true armets, and what I'm going to use is like the working definition of armet here is a close-fitted helmet shaped to the head that has hinged cheek pieces on either side so that the entire lower part of the face opens to permit getting the helmet on and off, but when it's closed, provides a very close fit to the wearer's head. The first time that we really see it in art is around 1410 with the publication of Fiore di Liberi's Fior di Battaglia manuscript. The It's a fighting treatise put out by an Italian fencing master around 1410, but in the armored combat sections, we see a lot of what look like early armet designs. So these are examples from the Getty version of the manuscript, and you can see that the guy on the left with the longsword is wearing a very close-fitting helmet with plates that form underneath his neck and chin to fit closely to the head. Here's another example of an early armet being worn on horseback with a visor. You'll note that the visor is similar in design to what we saw on the Venetian grand bassinets. Here is an example of two armets. So the guy on the left is wearing one without a visor. The guy on the right has the visor down, but what makes them characteristic of armets is that tight, close fit under the chin as the plates form to the jaw and the neck. And then finally here, you see this guy's caving in his buddy's face with a poleaxe, and he is wearing a very typical early armet. What I want you to note here is the shape of the skull and then the way that the face protection forms kind of a scooped out bowl that comes from under the chin and up to basically the sight, the top of the sight. So the actual ocular without a visor in this case is formed by the lower edge of the facial opening and then the top edge of that bowl that protrudes out into the front. And the reason I'm pointing out that particular style is because one of the earliest actual survivals of an armet, which used to be in the Sherberg collection, it was Sherberg number 57, matches that image pretty well, if not exactly. So here is Sherberg number 57. You can see that the in profile, you get that same scooped bowl shape of the cheek, of the hinged cheek plates. The side of the helmet, you see that kind of bar across the side of the helmet where the two plates come together. That's a flange that's actually protecting the hinge itself. So if you remember to the Venetian great bassinets, the hinge was pretty much completely exposed on the outside. On the armets, the hinge seems to be attached to the inside of the helmet, and then the attachment points, at least on the top, are typically protected. The actual hinge mechanism where the pin goes through is protected by this flange. You'll also notice that there are vervails along the lower edge of the neck here to attach a very short aventail. From the front and from the back here, you can see kind of a combined image of the different views of this helmet. You can see how on the back of the helmet, the skull and the back of the neck are continuous, and then it narrows into what people usually call the tail of the armet there, and then the cheek pieces, as they close around the neck, form the additional protection around the sides of the back of the neck, and then ultimately all the way around to the front. This is an Italian fresco of around the same time, dated to between 1410 and 1411. And you'll notice that here in the bottom left, there is another person wearing a very similarly profiled armet. The earliest known example of an armet on an effigy is actually on a German effigy of 1416. Dietrich Hofer. And you can see what gives it away as an armet is the way that it comes in close around the bottom of the jaw, and then you can see the locking mechanism on the front and center of the throat to actually secure the cheek plates into position. Another great example of an early surviving armet is the Sherberg number 18 armet, which is what we have an example of here. So taking a look at Sherberg number 18, you can see that the basic profile of the helmet is very similar in shape to the previous one that we looked at. So this one dates, the dating changes over time, but it's usually dated to around 1420, 1415, 1430 in that neighborhood. So roughly in the first quarter of the 15th century, kind of bleeding into the second quarter of the 15th century. But the profile is very similar. Notable differences are the side pivots, which would become kind of standard on armets. Side pivots very similar to the way a bassinet visor is attached. It still has the flange to protect the hinge. It still retains the vervales around the bottom of the neck for a short aventail. But what you're gonna notice on this armet is it has actual breaths. So the holes punched into the helmet are present on this. That's not very common on armets. And the big design feature that everybody sees right away is what I call the picket fence, but the teeth that are cut into the top of the cheek plates. So what this does is it still provides protection all the way up to almost the lined up with that this edge here. So you actually have a very small gap for which weapons can get into the helmet, but it still allows you to kind of see through that. So again, like we always say, armor is always a trade-off between protection and some other desirable feature, in this case, vision. You're able to see a lot more, but this is now weaker than the previous example that we looked at. Can these be bent? Yes. Can they be broken off? Yes, it's definitely possible. But the wearer, the designer of this helmet, decided that at least the experimentation of adding additional vision was worth that trade-off and the potential loss of protection in this particular spot. Now, with the visor down, you're going to end up mitigating that. We'll talk about that more when we take a look at the actual helmet example that we have here. One aside real quick is everybody likes to point out like the one thing that, you know, some scenario that could happen that could potentially defeat armor. Remember, the point of armor is not to make you invulnerable. It doesn't exist to turn you into, you know, you're not supposed to be completely invulnerable on the battlefield. What it's supposed to do is make you more survivable in a combat situation. So there will always be some way to defeat the armor. Otherwise, you're going to end up locking yourself in a steel vault where you can't move and you're completely combat ineffective. You need to be able to see, you need to be able to breathe, you need to be able to fight. Ultimately, even in today's technology, armor is never completely protective. In order to be able to fight, there's always going to be some sort of trade-off. This is one of them. So somebody decided that seeing was pretty important, and I could agree with them. Now, if, you know, the moon is in the seventh house, Jupiter aligns with Mars, and a warhammer happens to hit right here and bend one of these things in and allow weapon penetration, yeah, it's going to kill you, but we need to temper that kind of thought process with how likely is that really these people are moving, they're competent at fighting, you're not going to present the weaknesses of your armor to your opponent. Okay, so moving on to later and what would become more typical 15th and later 15th century armament design. This is an example from the Met of an armament dated to around 1430 to 1440. You'll notice that the skull is a little bit more rounded over now. It's a little bit less bassinet shaped. There's now a medial ridge. The medial ridge on the helmet is a lot more pronounced than it was on previous iterations. It still has a side hinged pivot. This particular one still retains vervales. We'll see that later armets end up going away from the vervales. It still has the flange to protect the hinges on the cheek plates, but one of the notable differences is this additional plate on the forehead. So armets ended up getting a reinforcement plate attached above the top edge of the facial opening to reinforce the forehead. You'll also notice that unlike the number 18 armet, later armets typically do not include breaths. In fact, I'm not sure of any that include breaths. So what we do see though is the facial opening on the armet when the visor is up tends to form this kind of T shape. So the facial opening tends to kind of expose the nose too when the visor is up. So that would definitely aid in not only vision, but more importantly, breathing. Other notable features of later armets are the inclusion of the rondel. So You can see on the back of this, on the back of the throat of this armored example here, there is a rondel that is projected off the back of the helmet on a little post. We'll see what kind of role that plays in a little bit when we talk about wrapper plates. But before we get there, I want to talk about visors. So the visors on later armets, if you look at this one, you'll see that the actual visor itself only includes the lower edge of the sight, the part where you look through. Only the lower edge is actually attached to the visor. The upper edge of the sight is actually formed by the lower part of the brow plate. So when you raise the visor, that brow plate is obviously not moving, and only the lower half of your sight is raised. There are two different kinds of visors. There are visors that do include the upper half. So here's an example of a first half of the 15th century armet, and you'll see that on this particular example, the visor itself includes both the lower half and upper half of the sight. So it's a little bit more robust of a visor. For whatever reason, there are images. Here is a 1440 to 1450 fresco from Italy that shows a lot of armets, and they appear to have visors like that example where the visor is the more robust design, where it's on both the top and the bottom. But for the second half of the 15th century, it seems to have been a lot more typical for the visor to only be that lower half and then allow the rest of the helmet to form the top half of that sight. The other important feature that really makes the armet very well suited to cavalry use is the inclusion of the additional wrapper plate, which is an optional feature that can be added to an armet. So if we look at this particular armet here, you'll see that there is a strap that goes around the back. Now you can see maybe why that rondel exists. But more importantly here, the wrapper plate is an entirely additional plate that fits to the front of the armet, and it includes a reinforcement for the lower half of the face, and also usually includes articulated plates that now extend downward to form a continuous plate protection from basically the above the mouth down to overlapping the chest, so that the throat is considerably more protected than wearing the armet without the wrapper plate. So the drawback is when the wrapper plate is on, the armet itself is going to become less mobile, especially from side to side, because of the way that it overlaps with the chest. So it's going to hit the chest, it's going to bind on the chest as you move. But that's a desirable feature when you're in a cavalry situation, you're on horseback, you now have a very well defended throat, an extra layer of steel across the lower half of the head. So if you do get struck by a lance, it shouldn't be able to snap your head to the side as easily. It provides a smooth glancing surface and double reinforcement on the place where you're likely to take a lance strike. You'll also notice that there is a peg sticking out of the visor that fits neatly into the wrapper plate. That's a lifting peg so that you can still grab the peg and lift up the visor as necessary, because the visor can raise and lower even with the wrapper plate in place. Here is another example of a surviving armet with a wrapper. The rondel on this particular one is a restoration. The skull and the wrapper plate are both original, but probably not associated, because you'll notice that the gap in the wrapper plate for the lifting peg does not line up with the hole on the visor for where the lifting peg would have gone. But they both share similar maker's marks, so they were probably both made in the same workshop. However, they probably weren't intended specifically for each other. But that is how they're displayed now. And you can see that that rondel actually not only forms a place, it does protect the straps in the back a little bit to protect the wrapper plate, but it also forms a nice little place for those straps to sit on, so that the wrapper plate stays very stable on the helmet. Okay, so now what we'll do is take a look at the example that we have here. So this is a reproduction of the Cherbourg number S18.
and dated to, like we said, around 1420, 1415, in that kind of first portion of the 15th century. The original, the visor, does not survive, but we'll come back to that in a minute. So taking a look at the features, if you look at it from profile, you get that characteristic swept kind of bowl scooped look that we see in early 15th century armaments. The skull from profile forms a peak similar to the way that bassinet skulls were shaped at the time. This is the border of the hinged cheek plate. Here's the flange that protects the hinge mechanism, which is just under here on the inside. So here you can see the rivets that attach the hinge to the inside, and then the actual hinge portion with the pin going through it is right underneath the flange. Breadths on the right side, a small number of breadths on the left side, and then the picket fence in the front here. The holes around here are for a sewn-in liner. This particular helmet at this present time has modern padding in it, so that's why you don't see thread here right now holding in a liner. And then we have vervails around the lower edge to attach a very short aventail. And then looking at the back of the helmet, you can see that the skull is continuous down to the base of the back of the neck, and then the sides of the neck wrapping around to the front are formed by the hinged cheek plates. This is the mechanism that you use to open and close the cheek plates. So all it requires is a 90 degree turn, it unlatches it, and then the cheek plates can be hinged independently. And this is what enables you to get the helmet on and off, because the opening in the bottom of the helmet is far too narrow to actually slip over the top of your head. This is one of the big advantages of the armet, is that you get that kind of close fit that other types of helmets don't offer. So here, looking at the back again, you can see that narrow tail piece and how it comes down. And then when the hinge plates close, that's how you get that complete protection there. So to close it, it just slips over here, rotate 90 degrees, and it's locked in place. So after discussion with the owner, one of the things that we think is probably incorrect on this particular interpretation is the additional holes, the breadths cut into the visor. If you take a look at this sketch from my friend Augusto, you'll see that this is probably more likely how the visor would have been designed. So remember, we discussed before that this is potentially a weak point in the visor, that these can be bent or damaged. So when you do take advantage of using the visor and you lower that visor into position, you would want to reinforce that potential weak spot on the helmet itself. So having a solid plate here instead of a plate punched with holes would help reinforce that point of the visor where damage can occur. And when you are wearing the visor, you'd typically be wearing it because you want maximal protection. So that's why you would do it there. And then, of course, the visor itself rotates on pivots, very similar to the way a bassinet functions, with pins that are removable on either side so that the visor can be taken off the helmet.
All right, so now what we're going to do is actually put the helmet on. I'll show you how to put it on and off, how it functions. We'll talk about things like vision and movement. To rotate the pin 90 degrees, it'll unlatch. Hopefully you can still hear me. Now the mechanism is locked into place and I can see. With the visor up, vision is, it's somewhat restricted down here, but it's really incredible the amount of the field of view that you get. Using my old peripheral vision test, I can actually see both my hands right now looking straight ahead. So that's pretty good peripheral vision. Looking up, I do see this out of the top of my eyes, but very little is actually restricted. And then it's very easy to see through the picket fence portion. It's definitely a feature that enhances the visibility of this helmet considerably compared to some of the others. If this was completely blocked off with no breaths, my vision everywhere from here down, so my hand is now below the level of the picket fence, everything from here down would just be black. Because of the picket fence, I can see my fingers very easily at this level. And then the breath, I can still see my hand on this side very easily. With the visor down, I'll put the visor down. I'm going to do the same peripheral vision test. I'm not sure how well you'll be able to hear me. As far as breathing goes right now, it's virtually unrestricted because of the visor being up and because of the picket fence and the breath. So with the visor down, now I can still see my fingers right about here. I think it's just a little bit more in than where it was before. It's still very good. I do lose a significant portion of the vision above me. And if the visor were designed like we think it probably would have been with this blocked off, I would kind of have a interruption in my vision right here, but I would still be able to see down here. In more typical Armet designs, pretty much everything from, so I can see my fingers out of the actual oculars here. So everything from here down would be obstructed if this were completely blocked off, but I would be very well protected. I still breathe fairly well, even with the visor down, but if this were completely closed, you'd start to really be breathing your own air back in, and breathing would get a lot more restrictive. As far as movement goes, movement is pretty excellent with an Armet. You can move your head up and down, side to side is virtually unrestricted as the lower edge of the helmet floats above the shoulder line and collarbones so that it's not impinging on you. You get a little bit of drag from the Aventail, but that's really insignificant. So rocking my head side to side, if this were fitted to me and sat up a little bit higher, it would fit even better there. But overall, the mobility provided by the Armet is really excellent compared to other designs of medieval helmets. Very minimal restriction. It's comfortable. It's relatively light. Visibility is pretty good. With the visor up, it's excellent. In later Armet designs, I would suspect breathing can become an issue, especially with the visor down and the wrapper plate in place on later 15th century designs. Taking it off is simple, just turn the pin and open it. The visor will not open with the cheek plates will not open with the visor down. So I hope what you see is that the Armet is not only what I consider a very aesthetically pleasing helmet, but it is also very well suited to being a versatile combat helmet. Without the wrapper plate on, it gets very good mobility around the neck. With the visor up, it gets very good vision. You can see a lot. Because of the shape of the later facial openings, you can breathe with the visor up. With the visor down, breathing does become considerably more restricted, and with the wrapper plate on, doubly so, because now that air exchange has to go through two overlapping plates, but it becomes considerably more protective. So perhaps in a ground scenario, fighting with an Armet, no wrapper, maybe removal of the visor, visor up. In a cavalry situation, you could lower the visor to reinforce the front of the oculars, include the wrapper plate, and now you're considerably more protected. That is everything that I wanted to discuss today. In the future, hopefully I can get my hands on a late 15th century Armet with a wrapper so that you guys can see how that actually functions in person. And until next time, if you guys like the video, please give me a thumbs up. And subscribe if you haven't already. Feel free to follow me on Facebook. All the links to vendors and information is down in the description, and we'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks. Bye.